Stephen Gold is a musicologist, a professor, and an author. His 2006 book, Life of Haydn, was released to high acclaim. His new book, Beethoven's Last, comes out later this week, and we're pleased to have him on the show. In contrast to The Life of Haydn, which was an exhaustive portrait of Haydn's life, Beethoven's Last focuses pretty specifically on the last couple weeks of Beethoven's life and his death in 1827. Can you tell us a little bit about his death and the circumstances surrounding it?
Sure. Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. In 1827, Beethoven was 55 years old. He was stone deaf, and he was a very ill man. We don't know the specific cause of death. Theories have been floated with everything from hepatitis A to lead poisoning to gastrointestinal failure to syphilis. What we do know is March 26th of the same year, Beethoven died. At his side was his friend Anselm Hüttenbrenner, as well as his sister-in-law Teresa, and possibly his housekeeper Sally. Mm-hmm. We know that his last words were, "Pity, pity, too late," in reference to a gift of wine that he had received earlier.
Do you know anything about this wine?
Sure. The wine was a gift from Schott Publishing House. It was thought to be white wine. At the time, German whites were considered to be the best wines in Europe, if not the world.
Hmm. Beethoven makes these remarks about the wine, and he breathes his last, and he's gone. And then what happens?
So for me, this is where the story gets really interesting. Immediately after passing, Beethoven finds himself in a courtyard. And it's not immediately recognizable, but it's very familiar. It would be very similar to the thermal spas that he frequented outside of Vienna around 1801 when his health started to deteriorate. So he finds himself in this courtyard and is immediately struck with this sensation. And it's not that he can hear, and it's not anything like what he remembers hearing to be, but he can feel sound. Mm-hmm. He feels the sounds of the courtyard, the sounds of the spa, rustling leaves, trickles of water, the soft murmurs of women echoing through the halls of the spa. And he feels these sounds coming and going. You see, it's not that the sound is coming in through his ears or even his head. The reception, if you will, is his whole body. And he can even anticipate that moment before the sound arrives. And what a unique sensation. So what does Beethoven do? He sings. Da 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 da. So he finds himself in this courtyard and he surveys his surroundings. There's a staircase leading up to a pair of doors. So he begins to walk across the courtyard, and imagine, he feels his feet inside of his shoe, but he also feels the sound, the soft clop of the sole of his shoe on the stones of the courtyard. Mm. I can't imagine. It's got to be just glorious. Mm-hmm. So he ascends the stairs to this set of double doors, large oak doors, and one is slightly ajar.
They call this the active door, the one that has the handle that you open when you're not opening both doors, when there's like French doors. Okay.
Okay.
So he opens up this door at the top of the stairs. He goes in. What does he find?
Right. So Beethoven finds himself in a small reception. There's a reception desk with a bouquet of lilies, a small business card holder, receptionist. He introduces himself. She welcomes him to any of the rooms. And he looks for his pocketbook to maybe tip her a few florins. He was known to do that sort of thing. When he's struck by this sound, this thing that he has never heard before, this glorious sound, and he thinks to himself, what type of musical instrument might this be? When the receptionist picks up the telephone. It's a telephone. So he, you know, Beethoven is fairly confused. He's never experienced a phone conversation before, so he looks on. And the conversation starts out, matter of fact, kind of, you know, business as usual. Hello, yes, this is her. And as Beethoven watches, her face transforms to one of, you know, surprise and elation. I got the job. Thanks very much. Oh, yes, yes. No, I don't think that's too soon. We can work something out. Sure. And as she's speaking, she sort of shifts the receiver to her shoulder and takes her purse out, starts taking things from the desk, pens, post-it notes, office supplies, and concludes her conversation. Yes, yes, no problem. I'll see you then. Thanks very much. Puts the phone down, makes her way around the desk, and shouts down a hallway, Anton, I'm leaving. I quit right now. Don't call me. I have caller ID and I won't fucking pick up. So Beethoven is left in this empty reception area by himself.
So what happened? What did he do?
To be perfectly honest, we don't know. I mean, it's something that's baffled Beethoven scholars like myself for the last 200 years. We essentially get to the end of the end, and we have this glaring, gaping hole in what happened next. I think every Beethoven scholar has his or her pet theory. I certainly have mine, but we don't know.
If you don't mind sharing it, what's your theory?
Well, sure. There's some evidence that would suggest that he started to sing his 10th symphony, the melody from it at the very least. He was working on the 10th symphony before his death, and I've been able to tie the evidence surrounding some of the song that he sung in the courtyard that we discussed earlier, yeah, to those sketches for the 10th symphony. So I think it makes sense that he would perform the 10th symphony with the only instrument he had available to him, which was his voice.
I guess I don't really get it. Why would he start singing?
He loved music. He made music. He surrounded himself with music. He lived music, and now he was experiencing, feeling music. So, why wouldn't he?
A lot of people love making music. I love music. You love music, but we don't spontaneously start singing.
Let me put it to you this way. I am a Beethoven scholar. I've been studying this man and his work for decades. If there's anyone alive that knows how Beethoven might have reacted to this situation, what's in his head, what makes him tick, that's me, okay? So, not to sound pretentious, but I think I know.
I know, okay. Just for me as a layman, outside of the situation, looking in, just seems really strange that he would burst into song. It's an awkward situation for him. I don't know. I just think that...
Frankly, I don't really care what you think. I didn't come on here to try and defend my current theory or any of the material you have in front of you there. I mean, I
Stephen, nobody's asking you to defend your work. All I'm saying is somebody who's new to this story, and I feel like maybe I have a valuable perspective, maybe I don't, but looking in...
Okay, what kind of show is this? Are we on TV, public broadcast, is this some YouTube bullshit?
It's web-based.
Web-based.
There's a lot of content.
I write books. There's an art to that. You play around on the internet? Come on.
Our budget does kind of present certain limitations.
Okay, well, maybe that's the breakdown here. Maybe that's the breakdown here. Your producer, Katie, called me up, asked me for a favor. She used to date my landlord. I said, sure. Question, answer. Thank you. Goodbye. Okay. Are we at the goodbye part yet? I think maybe we are. I appreciate you having me here, but listen, we're done. Read the book.
Here in the city, the quiet flies, passing underneath the lights. Spear from nowhere, a gift from the night. Spear in the city, moving through darkened streets and avenues, through the plate glass of the bistro it flew.
To become a gift.